गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई थैंक द ऑर्गेनाइजिंग कमेटी, स्पेशली डॉक्टर वितुल गुप्ता एंड माय बैचमेट डॉक्टर सोनिया गुप्ता एंड टू बी अ पार्ट ऑफ दिस एकेडमिक फीस्ट ऑफ ऑल द फिजिशियंस. सो आई एम टेकिंग अ वेरी पर्टिनेंट टॉपिक विच वी हैव ऑल अंडरगॉन थ्रू लास्ट 1.5 ईयर. सो एवरी फिजिशियन, एवरी हेल्थ केयर वर्कर, वी ऑल शुड नो द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ इन्फेक्शन कंट्रोल. सो बेसिक थिंग्स विच आई विल डिस्कस, फोर मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग इज हैंड हाइजीन. And second is proper use of personal protective equipment. So these two are the fundamental pillars, and the hand hygiene is the basic step to cut down the rate of hospital acquired infections. So as we all, the hospital acquired infections for all hospital doctors, healthcare workers, staff, as well as visitors, they all are at risk of hospital acquired infections, so they can lead to major complications. So I will be dealing briefly about the historical aspect with the hospital acquired infection, how we define this, what is the impact of these infections, then how we can cut down these in our institutions by the infection control program, then the four most important bundles, that is ventilator associated pneumonia, catheter associated UTI, central line associated bloodstream infection and surgical site infection. These four bundles, they are the important in hospital acquired infections. Then how we can cut down by standard precautions, transmission based precautions, and briefly about needle stick injury and post exposure prophylaxis. So going to the in the history, the first most contribution in the by the Florence Nightingale in 1854, where she clearly stated that the first requirement of hospital, that it should do the sick no harm. Then we all should know the contribution of Joseph Lister, who used carbolic acid for antisepsis during the wound dressing of the surgeries. And in the present era, the various guidelines have been given by Central Disease Control Atlanta in USA, as well as we are having National Nosocomial Infection Surveillance System, then guidelines given by Healthcare Infection Control Practice Advisory Committee. So these standard guidelines, they are available. And the surveillance performed by INEC. So this is the first requirement in a hospital, that it should do the sick no harm. How we define these infections? Any infection acquired in the hospital by a patient who was admitted for a reason other than that infection. Secondly, in whom infection was not present or incubating at the time of admission. Then symptoms appear at least 48 hours after admission. In addition, it also includes occupational infection among staff of the facility. 1.7 million hospitalized patients, they acquire infections every year. 5 to 10% among them, they develop hospital-acquired infections. On a given day, 1 in 31 has hospital-acquired infection. The main burden is in the developing country. As compared to the developed country, we are having 10%. So low and middle income countries, they are having 2 to 20 fold higher burden as compared to the developed nations. The main impact of these infection is increased personal cost to the patient, increased hospital stay, long-term disability, and even they can lead to mortality. What are the factors which influence these infections? The main thing is microbial agents. We are surrounding with viruses, bacteria, parasites, fungi. Then what is the patient susceptibility, patient immune response? What is the bacterial resistance? As Dr. Vitul clearly pointed out, because of injudicious use of antibiotics, there is a lot of multidrug resistance. Then the environmental factors. So the main host factors are immunocompromised host, severity of illness, broken skin and mucous membrane, aggressive medical and therapeutic interventions. In hospital environment, we can have contaminated air conditioning, food and water supply can be contaminated, proper layout facilities in the hospital, so there should be proper layout of the theaters as well as the ICU, bed to bed distance should be proper, presence of construction and renovation activities in the hospital, they can lead to more of fungal infections. Then iatrogenic factors are pathogens on the hands of medical personnel, failure to follow basic infection control practices in between patients. Then as the patients are ill, they are in intensive care unit, they are prone to various invasive devices. like vascular access, we can have mechanical ventilation, urinary catheter, endotracheal intubation, misuse of antibiotics. Then microbial flora, 90% are all hospital acquired infection, they are due to bacterial causes, and 10% by viral, fungal, and protozoal infection. Among the most common pathogens in hospital acquired infection are escape pathogens, that is Enterococcus, Staphylococcus aureus, Klebsiella, Acinetobacter baumannii, and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. What are the sources? One is medical personnel, which can be either colonized or they may be transient carrier. Then use of invasive devices. Then we can have contaminated hospital environment and patient's own flora. It can be cutaneous flora, GIT flora, or it can be genitourinary tract flora. So main mode of transmission is contact, either by direct contact or by indirect contact. Second is vector-borne transmission like malaria, dengue, chikungunya, they can transfer by the bite of mosquito. Then airborne or droplet, tuberculosis, measles, COVID infection, so all these they are by the airborne and droplet nuclear infection. Then common vehicle transmission can be from the non-sterile supplies of medications as well. So either food, water, medications, they can lead to, or from the equipment. We have not properly sterilized the equipment. So all these things can lead to transfer of hospital-acquired infection. So CDC has listed all these 13 categories of hospital-acquired infection, but I will basically deal with these four. Out of these four, COTI is number one, comprising about 36%, followed by CLABSI. Then we are having VAB 11% and surgical site infection 20%. Every hospital, not a medical college, but every private hospital as well who wants for the NABH accreditation or for NABL or for other, for their prestigious issue as well, the guidelines have been given that every hospital should have an infection control officer and infection control team in their premises, and they should comprise, and the committee should comprise, in every hospital should formulate a committee policy, then they should implement all the NABH standards. The basic aim of infection control is to decrease microbial population, to eliminate danger of transmission of microorganism from one organism to another. Basically, who is responsible, but we are giving our responsibility only to microbiologist or to the infection control officer. So mainly in all the hospitals, microbiologists, they play a key role in infection control. But I must say that it is the responsibility of each and every healthcare worker to contribute to cut down the rate of hospital-acquired infections. So Hospital Infection Control Committee, the generally constitution, the chairperson should be a hospital administrator. Member secretary should be from the microbiology department. Then the other member representations from the clinical sides like medicine, surgery, gynae. Then we are having allied services like the CSSD department, housekeeping department, nursing department, pharmacy department, and engineering department. So this is the formulation of Hospital and Infection Control Committee. And in the team is day-to-day basis. They are comprised by infection control nurse. Each hospital should have at least one infection control nurse for 200 beds. Then we should have infection control officer. So our hospital has initiated a newsletter bulletin where quarterly the Department of Microbiology is giving all the alerts to the clinicians about various rates in the hospital, antibiogram of our institute. We are quarterly circulating to all our hospital colleagues. Now, basically, now I come to the infection bundle, how we can cut down these four bundles. Now, these four bundles, the benchmark has been set by WHO as well as by CDC. They have given a benchmark for COTI, for example, 1.5. By WHO, it is given 4.1 per 1,000 catheter days. Similarly, for VAB, the range varies from 1.3 to 23.9. Similarly, for CLABSI, 1.1 to 12.2. Now, how we diagnose these infections? Now, firstly, I come to COTI. It is catheter-associated UTI. You should keep in mind only two things. One is device criteria. Second is clinical criteria. Device criteria means patient should be on Foley's catheter for at least 2 calendar days. Secondly, clinical criteria, complaint of fever, urgency, dysuria, leukocytosis. Then culture criteria, positive microbiology report, quantitative culture showing a growth of single microorganism or at least two microorganism, and growth should be significant. Now how we can prevent this COTTI? Main is insertion bundle. Avoid catheterization unless there is compelling indication. Maintain appropriate aseptic practice during insertion. Non-touch technique. Sterile set should be used. It should be secured properly. In the maintenance bundle, we have to do daily catheter care for at least in every shift. We have to do catheter care thrice a day for every patient. Drainage bag should always be above floor, and we should maintain closed drainage system. Second is central line associated bloodstream infection. Again, device criteria, more than 2 days. Patient can present with fever, chills, hypotension, apnea, bradycardia, or hypothermia. Then presence of laboratory confirmed bloodstream pathogen. Here, laboratory confirmed means we should exclude skin commensals like diphtheroid and coagulase negative staphylococci. Now in the CVC or insertion bundle, the foremost important thing as we are inserting something, for main priority is on hand decontamination. Full sterile barrier precaution should be used. For skin antisepsis, we can use 2% chlorhexidine. Then we should choose appropriate catheter site for the selection, and we should daily review the need for central lines. In the maintenance bundle, whenever the patient is on central line, before and after patient contact, we have to use the hand hygiene technique. Daily observation for any sign and symptoms of infection. We should check the dressing daily. It should be intact, dry, adherent, transparent dressing should be used. Whenever we are assessing the catheter for any medication, we should scrub the hub with either chlorhexidine or 70% alcohol. Daily assessment for the need of central line should be done. Then third event is ventilator-associated events. Initially, it was called as ventilator-associated pneumonia. Now in CDC 2020 guidelines, they have changed it to ventilator-associated event. So event is a three-tier approach, where first condition is ventilator-associated condition. Second is IVAC, that is infection-related ventilator-associated condition. And third is PVAP, that is possible or probable VAP. And fourth is the clinically confirmed VAP case. Now what is the diagnostic criteria for ventilator-associated event? In VAC, that means worsening of oxygenation, either increased fractional oxygen pressure or positive end expiratory pressure more than 3 cm water. In IVAC, in addition to this, we can start patient with either leukocytosis or leukopenia and start of antimicrobial by the clinical suspicion. Stage 3, PVAP means IVAC plus culture should be positive of endotracheal aspirate or of BAL. In stage 4 or the final stage is VAP, where we include chest X-ray finding as well. So in the ventilator care bundle, basically elevation of the head of the bed to between 30 and 45 degree, daily sedation, vacation, and assessment for weaning or extubation should be checked. Peptic ulcer disease profile X-rays as well as deep venous thrombosis, DVT profile X-ray should be given. A fifth bundle is added in 2010, that is daily oral care with chlorhexidine. Now, fourth bundle is surgical site infection. It is important for all the surgeons, the infections that develop at surgical site within 30 days postoperative period. But it is extended up to 90 days in case of implant surgeries, breast and joint surgeries. We have to do surveillance till 90 days. The division can be, it can be superficial, it can be deep or organ space surgical site infection. So basically surgical site infection is clinical decision, that is purulent discharge around the wound or at the insertion site of the drain. Pain, tenderness, swelling, erythema, along with culture report when we are doing the wound swab or the pus aspirate, it yields organism, so culture positive. In SSI bundle, we should be having preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative. In preoperative thing, before surgery, in any elective procedure, we have to treat remote infection. So this is the foremost indication, no shaving. So if we want to do shaving, at least before the operation, immediately, not a night before. So we have to use the clippers or the shaving cream. So shaving is not recommended. Only the depilatory creams or clippers can be used. appropriate use of surgical prophylaxis. We have to limit OT environment, OT traffic. Proper surgical attire, proper surgical scrub. In OT environment, there should be air changes, minimum 20 air changes. Positive pressure 2.5 Pascal. Temperature should be in a range of 21 plus minus 3. Similarly, relative humidity 20 to 60 degree. And air supply through high efficiency particulate air filters. During operation, proper skin antisepsis, good surgical technique, good hemostasis, and wound dressing should be there. In post-operative period, we have to check control glucose levels as well as normothermia. To cut down the rate of these two are the other important bugs in the hospital, Clostridium difficile and methicillin-resistant Staph aureus. For these two types, we need contact precaution, which I will elaborate further. So for Clostridium difficile infection, we have to use contact precaution. We have to comply with CDC hand hygiene guidelines. We have to educate the healthcare personnel. Similarly, for methicillin-resistant Staph aureus, we have to isolate the infected patient, and we have to take surveillance culture of healthcare staff. Now, all these four bundles, basically we have to, in the pre-intervention phase, we should know the baseline rates of our hospital, knowledge, survey about the bundles, then we have to do the team rounds, intervention phase, then in the post-intervention, we have to measure and analyze the rates and compliance to the bundles. Then we have to change our policy according to our hospital rates. Now this was all about the infection bundles. Now I am coming briefly about the standard precautions and transmission-based precaution. So standard precaution, initially the term used in 1985 is universal. That means applied to whole uniform universe, regardless of patient's status, sero status. So body fluid to which universal precautions apply, they are blood, semen, vaginal secretion, CSF, pleural, and all body fluids. But do not apply to feces, nasal secretion, sputum, saliva, sweat, and tears, unless they are blood-tinged. So after that, because it was to the universe, and this is the main problem, because in emergency, when we are dealing with the patient, we don't take proper precautions. Hamare paas resident aate hain, kehte hain, ma'am, sample le liya, agle din hum unko report dete hain, patient hepatitis B positive hai, HIV positive hai, wo double gloves dalna shuru ho jate hain. So that is not the way to protect this. So before, maximum chances of these infections are in emergency. So we should be careful while having our first contact with the patient. So then later on in 1996, CDC has given a two-tier approach. They had given one term used standard precaution. Now we use the terminology standard precautions and transmission-based precaution. Standard precautions mean applicable to all patients regardless of their diagnosis. Transmission-based mean depending upon their route of transmission. As I have told, whether they are contact, whether they are airborne transmission, depending upon the route, we have to take the precautions. So for prevention of hospital-acquired infection, either we have to take standard precautions or transmission-based precautions like airborne, droplet, and contact. Now, contact precautions, they are indicated when we are dealing with Clostridium difficile, MRSA, vancomycin-resistant enterococci. Here, the foremost thing is hand hygiene, gown is must, and gloves. In case of droplet infection, droplet means the size of particle is more than 5 micrometer. This is indicated in cases of pertussis, respiratory syncytial virus, flu virus, swine flu, meningococcal infection. Then airborne infection where particle size is less than 5. For example, in tuberculosis, chickenpox, and measles. The basic difference in droplet and airborne is, in droplet, surgical mask is indicated, whereas in airborne infections, we need negative pressure room and N95 or respiratory mask. So in every, where we isolate the patient, we should put signage on the private rooms or on the isolation beds that contact precaution, gloves and gown are must for droplet, surgical mask are must, and for airborne, N95 mask is must. Then we should need assess for the isolation of the patient. Whether we should identify the need for isolation, whether patient need protective isolation or patient needs source isolation. Protective isolation is indicated for immunocompromised patient, bone marrow transplant, neutropenia patient. Whereas source isolation, we isolate the patient who is colonized with these multi-drug resistant pathogens. Now coming to the hand hygiene. This is the single most. Washing your hand with soap and water is one of the best ways to prevent hospital-acquired infection. Ignaz Semmelweis, which has given this hand hygiene technique, he is called as father of hand hygiene as well as father of infection control. So how these hands, they can transmit the infection. So when I am carrying one patient, the organisms are shed on the patient's skin or on the inanimate object. When we are going to first patient, these organisms, they are transferred to our hands. If I have not taken proper skin antisepsis, the organism will survive on my hands, and I am visiting the second patient, I will transfer my germs to the second patient. So this is the way how we can transmit the infection from one patient to another. So various hand washing agents are available, like in household we are doing routinely with soap and water. Alcohol, 70% alcohol is effective. We can have chlorhexidine, chloroxylenol, hexachlorophane, quaternary ammonium compound. These are commercial preparations available. Now types we all know, one is routine hand washing, second is antiseptic hand washing, and third is surgical. Surgical hand hygiene, I am not going into detail, mainly all the surgeons, they know the technique of surgical hand hygiene, at least for 3 to 5 minutes, and antiseptic hand wash, which we all are doing during COVID times as well, 20 to 30 seconds. So these are the 5 moments given by WHO before touching a patient, before doing any clean or aseptic procedure, after any body fluid exposure, after touching the patient, and after touching patient's rounding. So whenever opportunity-wise we are doing round in our hospital, the least compliant is after touching patient's rounding. Because unknowingly, doctor comes to the patient bedside, he touches the patient bed rail or the IV stand or the monitor. He does not know that these can also be contaminated. So least compliance, maximum compliance is before aseptic procedure and after touching a patient. But least compliance is with this opportunity, that is after touching patient's roundings. So hand washing technique, I think that everybody should know, but basically we should know these 6 steps given by WHO. At least each step should be followed 3 times, and minimum time we can take 20 to 30 seconds. Soap se karni hai, soap water se bhi kar sakte hain, we can use these antiseptic as well. The hand rubs are available. So basic technique here, you have to do palm to palm, then you have to do the back of your palm, we have to clean back, then interlacing the finger. Fourth is knuckles on both sides. So this is the main thing. And fifth step is by the thumbs, rotational thumbing, because this is the most missed area. And last step, you have to clean your fingertips. The sixth step is on both the hands and vice versa. So every step should be at least 3 strokes, and minimum time should be 20 to 30 seconds. And I think with this 1 year, everybody, all of us must be knowing about the hand hygiene steps. The most frequent area missed are fingertips, finger webs, palms, and the thumbs. The compliance rate, why they are less? The majority of the healthcare persons, they complain that there is lack of time. I am too busy. I have to see 10 patients. I don't have time for 20 seconds as well. Some complain of skin irritations by the various hand rubs available, high workload, understaffing, forgetfulness, or lack of infection control practices. So these can be leading to low hand hygiene compliance. Now coming to personal protective equipment, we all know gown, gloves, mask, face shield, these are the important constituents of PPE. Gloves, we can wear non-sterile gloves as well as sterile. So sterile before any aseptic procedures, and generally for during single examination, we can use non-sterile gloves as well. Gowns, whenever there is a risk of any blood or body fluid exposure, we should wear gown or a plastic apron over there. During any IV cannulation or central line, sometime we can have splash on our body, we should wear gown. Then similarly, face shield, eye visor, and goggles should be used. Caps, shoe covers, then mask. Mask are medical mask as well as the respirator and N95 mask available. So as I have already stated, for airborne, we have to use respirator mask. In addition to that, various aerosol-generating procedures like bronchoscopy, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, ventilation, tracheal intubation, in all these conditions, we have to wear respirator mask. So this is the proper use of PPE. The sequence of putting on PPE is called as donning, and sequence of removal of PPE is called as doffing. It is also very important in the right way you have to wear the PPE, and in the right way you have to dispose of the PPE. So during donning, the first thing we have to wear gown, then mask, third thing is goggles, and at the last, gloves. While during doffing, gloves should be removed first. So gloves first, goggles second, gown, and at last we have to remove the mask. And in between, after removal as well as before putting, we should be thorough with hand hygiene practice. Then we should take care of respiratory hygiene and cough fatigues. If no tissues are available, we have to cough or sneeze into the inner elbow. Now coming to the biomedical waste management, the Punjab Pollution Control Board has given a very stringent guidelines for the proper waste disposal, which can also be a threat for hospital environment. So biomedical waste management, very easy to remember because only four color categories: yellow, red, blue, and white. So yellow is basically for infectious non-plastic waste. Red category is for infectious plastic waste. Blue is basically for glassware. And white is for the shops. So every hospital should have these Punjab Pollution Control Board stringent guidelines. We should follow, put the right waste in right bin. Segregation is the single most important step for every healthcare worker, because majority of the sanitation workers, because of our improper segregation at the point of generation, it will lead to increased cost for the biomedical waste treatment, as well as improper mixing can lead to needle stick injury to the sanitation workers. So safe handling and disposal of sharps. We should be needle smart. Don't recap, do not bend the needle, do not remove. So we have to dispose of the needle. If we want to retain the syringe, at least we should use one hand scoop technique. Similarly, there can be a spill in the environment, so spill response should be there. And how we can clean the spill? Particularly, we have to cover the area of blood or body fluid spill with hypochlorite, 1% sodium hypochlorite, leave it there for 20 to 30 minutes, discard contaminated materials, then clean that area with routine hot water and detergent. Then sterilization and disinfection plays a key role in cut down of hospital acquired infection. All surgical instruments should be properly sterilized. We can use a variety of sterilization agents, and the most resistant in the resistance-wise are the endospores of bacteria, and least resistant are viruses. So Spalding gave a device classification for all critical devices that enter inside the body. We need sterilization, either steam sterilization, autoclave is the best method or a gold method for sterilization, unless the articles sterilized are heat sensitive. We can use dry heat, we can use ETO sterilization. Nowadays, very chemical agents are available, like glutaraldehyde, peracetic acid, hydrogen peroxide. These are available for sterilization. Second items are semi-critical, which contact with mucous membranes, like all endoscopes. So here we can use glutaraldehyde, orthophthaldehyde, or we can use hydrogen peroxide and peracetic acid. Non-critical items again need thorough cleaning with soap, water, and detergent, where we can use ethyl or isopropyl alcohol or quaternary ammonium compounds. Then all laboratory specimens, we should think that they all are infectious. Whenever you are sending samples to the department, we should take a proper precautions. We should label the specimen accordingly, and we should transport them in a covered containers. Now briefly about needle stick injury. An exposure that might place healthcare worker at risk of these three are the major bloodborne pathogens: hepatitis B, C, and HIV. Now, the estimated risk is highest with hepatitis B. You should remember a formula of 0.3, 3, and 30. 0.3 for HIV, 3% for hepatitis C, and 30% with hepatitis B. Now what we should do? Every hospital should have a post-exposure profile access guidelines. Immediate first aid. We should not be panic. Skin wound should be washed thoroughly with soap and running water. No evidence that antiseptics are useful. If there is splash on eyes, we should irrigate the eyes as well. report the incident to your area in charge or your supervisor. Then the consultant or the medicine consultant should do the risk assessment of that healthcare worker. What is the type of exposure, extent of injury, type of device, what are the baseline titer of healthcare worker, what is the source, whether it is HIV positive, HBV or HCV, then we should do the counseling of healthcare worker and follow up. So for hepatitis B exposure, we are lucky that for hepatitis B, the vaccination is available, but we all are in a false sense of security that we are vaccinated. All the vaccination, they don't give any healthcare worker 100% protection. So if you are vaccinated, you should at least know your anti-HBs titer. If your anti-HBs titer are more than 10 milli international unit, that means you are protective. So if healthcare worker is not vaccinated, we should start hepatitis B immunoglobulin as well as we have to start the vaccine. But if the healthcare worker is vaccinated, we should check his level. If more than 10, there is no need of worry. And if it is less than 10, then again we have to initiate the booster dose of hepatitis B. For hepatitis C and HIV, as no vaccine is available, for hepatitis C, interferons are not recommended for prophylaxis. We have to do the blood test at baseline, and we have to follow up the patient with liver function test and anti-HCV test at 4 to 6 months. Similarly, for HIV, we have to do pre- and post-test counseling. We have to take a baseline test, then at 6 weeks and 12 weeks. And we have to consult the patient. Depending upon the exposure code, we should start antiretroviral treatment, and it should be given for 28 days. And nowadays, the treatment given for ART prophylaxis for 28 days is tenofovir, then we are having amitriptyline, and we are having raltegravir. These three drugs are given for 28 days. And if the person is pregnant, then ideally we should avoid the pregnancy during this antiretroviral prophylaxis period, and mother should avoid lactating the baby during these 28 days period. Then last is prevention, as prevention is better than cure, so main prevention, education. Every hospital should have a robust infection control policy. Every healthcare worker should be educated, and we should engage, innovate, we should discuss all these things with our clinicians and colleagues. So education is the mainstay. Then hospital employees' health. We have to take more stress on hospital employee. Every hospital should provide post-exposure prophylaxis, tetanus toxoid vaccine, hepatitis B vaccine to their employees. And if the employee is coming after returning from work, they should be having a thorough health checkup of that employee. Then antimicrobial utilization. Similarly, antimicrobial stewardship program. Improper use, underuse, overuse, all these things can lead to multi-drug resistant. So every hospital should have antimicrobial stewardship program in place. And lastly, we should do the surveillance. Surveillance is ongoing monitoring, where you can analyze your hospital data or your clinic data, what are the rates of infection and how you can cut down these rates. So main five pillars of infection control: isolation and barrier precautions, decontamination of equipment, prudent use of antibiotics, hand washing, and decontamination of environment. So we all should pledge that we should break the chain of infection. It is the duty of each and every healthcare worker to break the chain to save our life. So thank you all for your patience listening.
Thank you, ma'am, for the wonderful talk. The session is now open for questions.
Supposing a patient is pregnant and we come to know that she is HIV positive, what should we do?
If the patient is pregnant and?
And HIV comes out to be positive.
Ma'am, HIV mother may positive or with needle stick injury?
Mother is positive.
Ma'am, with needle stick injury?
No. In routine testing, we come to know.
Ma'am, if mother is positive, we are having the ICTC center or counseling centers are available. Either we should counsel the mother, and we have to start with the antiretroviral treatment to the mother.
Okay.
We should check a thorough checkup for her spouse as well. Then we should counsel her. Nowadays, for whole 9 months, we are giving this regimen to the pregnant women, all through ICTC centers supported by government or ART centers. She should take the treatment. And initially, there was role that she should not feed, but nowadays they say that we can use the expressed milk for the baby. The mother can feed the baby after expressing the milk or boiling that milk as well.
Okay.
नीडल स्टिक इंजरी जनरली टू द हेल्थ केयर वर्कर, इफ न्यूली मैरिड है या स्टाफ नर्स है या वार्ड बॉय, हम उनको 28 डेज के लिए कहते हैं आपको अपना एब्सटिनेंस रखना है या कंट्रासेप्टिव यूज करना है. बट इफ दैट पीरियड द मदर, इफ समवन इज प्रेग्नेंट, देन वी कैन नॉट से. बट ड्यूरिंग 28 पीरियड्स आफ्टर वन मंथ वी विल अगेन टेस्ट द बेसलाइन लेवल ऑफ HIV इन दैट हेल्थ केयर वर्कर, देन वी स्टॉप द एंटी रेट्रोवायरल ट्रीटमेंट आफ्टर 28 डेज. So during 28 days, we should do the abstinence or use of contraceptive, and mother should avoid directly feeding to the baby if she has already, for the healthcare worker with needle stick injury. Okay. And otherwise, every pregnant in all ICTC center, in all microbiology department, all civil hospital and all government institutions, we are having integrated counseling and testing center where all pregnant women, they are enrolled, and during first trimester of pregnancy, they all are screened for the HIV status. And along with their spouse status.
Thank you.
If there are no further questions, we'll move on to the next session.
Hello. Excuse me, ma'am. How common is COVID infection in hospital acquired infections? How common is COVID in hospital acquired infections? What is the incident, or hasn't it been studied yet?
But a hospital acquired infection, the COVID has not the direct role, but we have to be more stringent with our infection control practices during the handling of this COVID pandemic. Because of this proper infection control practices, we are able to decrease the mortality rate, and you must have heard in all the newspapers, in DMC as well as in other big hospitals which are having these COVID patients, the mortality rate was basically less and the healthcare worker exposed. In our hospital, 1600 bedded hospital, only 10 or 20 healthcare workers they must have encountered during their interaction with the patients or during their COVID duties. They have done a stringent duty in the COVID wards as well. So I think direct link is not there with the COVID transmission, but if we have to be more thorough with our infection control practices before going to that area of isolation or of ward.
Is research is undergoing on that?
Which kind of
on COVID in hospital acquired infections, or isn't it not aware? You are not aware of that, right?
But I couldn't understand your question.
Is this being researched, or is it yet under research, or is it not in your knowledge?
Couldn't understand your question.
Is this मैम कि कोविड जो है वो अगर हॉस्पिटल एक्वायर्ड इन्फेक्शंस में अभी हो रहा है कि नहीं हो रहा है, कितना कॉमनली है?
हॉस्पिटल एक्वायर्ड इन्फेक्शन बाद में भी मैनिफेस्ट हो सकता है आफ्टर डिस्चार्ज ऑफ द पेशेंट. सो एटलीस्ट मिनिमम जो हमारा 48 आवर स्टे है, हमने पेशेंट आज घर से एक प्राइमरी या फीवर से आ रहे हो, आपके आने पे हमने पेशेंट के कैथेटर डाल दिया, तो पेशेंट डेवलप कैथेटर एसोसिएटेड यूटीआई, दिस इज लेबल्ड एज हॉस्पिटल एक्वायर्ड इन्फेक्शन. पेशेंट हैज कम फॉर सम अदर इन्फेक्शन टू द हॉस्पिटल फॉर ट्रीटमेंट, वी हैव गिवन एनी इन्वेसिव डिवाइस, आपने पेशेंट ने हॉस्पिटल का फूड कैंटीन से खा लिया, डायरिया हो गया, दैट विल अगेन लेबल्ड एज हॉस्पिटल एक्वायर्ड इन्फेक्शन. But similarly, these infections, they can manifest after discharge. So at least again, we have to follow 2 days after that. But similarly, these infections, they can manifest after discharge.